Welcome to the PC Gaming Vortex. Today we're coming at you with a special episode specifically about all of the drama that's happening with SOE, Sony Online Entertainment. So today I'm joined by Gallows, like usual, and we're joined by the magic of the internet, by Xaiveir. You might remember Xaiveir from our EverQuest 2 series. He also joined me at SOE Live this year, which was fantastic. So, as you know, we have a long history on this channel with SOE games. We have EverQuest 2. We have DCUO, which is a big one for us. Plus, we just witnessed the SOE Live just last year, and we covered that on the channel. So it's definitely something that's near and dear to our hearts, especially myself and Xaiveir, being as we played EverQuest and EverQuest 2 pretty much since the beginning. So these are franchises that are really important to us. So what happened recently is Sony Online Entertainment was sold from Sony over to a company called Columbus Nova. Now, Columbus Nova is an investment group, not a game company, and they have decided to take SOE and make them into Daybreak's Game Company. Now, obviously that raises a lot of questions. We don't know exactly what's going to happen. We didn't know. Everybody was kind of on the edge of their seats wondering what was going to occur. All we had was this PR statement. And the PR statement that came out, of course, was very specifically worded. And it stated things like, we're going to be focusing on all platforms. They specifically mentioned Xbox and PlayStation. And they specifically mentioned mobile games, which usually scares me when someone says they're going to do mobile games. That's not always the best thing. So it seems like they're definitely taking it in a different direction. While it is a more common direction, it's not necessarily the direction that SOE's been known for with PC and MMOs. So what we're going to do today is the three of us are going to talk from different perspectives. We're going to discuss what's going on, the fears, what we know so far, and what we think is going to happen when it comes to the death of SOE Games, I guess. I guess you can either refer to it as the death of SOE Games or the rebirth of the new era in Daybreak. I don't know how you want to look at it. So we'll start out by talking about the big news that just happened a couple days ago. So, out of nowhere, people just started getting let go. So we had one day where a lot of major names at SOE started to be let go. So we had Dave Jorgensen, who is in charge of pretty much all things EverQuest, I believe. Is that correct, Xaiveir?
Yeah, he was pretty much the face of the EverQuest franchise. He was tasked with next EQ2, EQ1, pretty much oversaw the entire operation and development.
Yeah, not to mention the fact that he was a major face when it came to the hype train that is associated with all this stuff. He is pretty much the face you think about, at least I think about when I think of EverQuest and EverQuest Next especially. The second person you think about is Brass. And I don't know her full name. Do you know her full name there, Xaiveir?
Yeah, her name is Linda Carlson. She's a wonderful, wonderful person.
Otherwise known as Brass the Dwarf. And she has every fanfare, every SOE Live I've gone to, she's been there. She is always in videos and community community events. She is not only just a fantastic person, but she really was associated with the EverQuest franchise in a positive way, in my opinion. So those two losses were kind of harsh. There's also some other losses we had that kind of tossed me for a loop. There is the person in charge of story and development for EverQuest Next. I have his name right here, actually. His name is Steve Donuser. I apologize if I pronounce that wrong, but he's lead content designer and head of story on EverQuest Next. He was let go. And associate producer for EverQuest Next, Eric Smith, was let go. Was there any other major names I was missing there, Xaiveir, that you recall?
Not off the top of my head, no. Those are the real major ones that were let go.
And those are pretty groundbreaking. I mean, so we'll start talking about these losses because they are just that, in my opinion. They're losses. Now, from a business perspective, you have to assume they had a reason. But being as though H1Z1 just came out, being as though EverQuest Landmark is kind of getting its footing and getting its identity in the gaming scene leading up to EverQuest Next, and being that EverQuest Next got such positive press, ripping out the core of its management team and its direction sounds pretty scary. So what do you think, Gallows? When it comes to removing big names like that, how do you think that's going to affect these projects?
Well, it's definitely going to have a major impact. What I see
as probably the least experienced as far as the SOE goes, is that obviously you can kind of tell due to the cuts that EverQuest and EverQuest 2 and Next have kind of been targeted in a sense. I mean, all of the games that have been on the Surface Early Access, you got your H1Z1 and so on and so forth, they have kind of remained, it's kind of a scary spot, but it's still pretty stable. Which makes me wonder how far along, you know, Next would be. Because to me, looking from the outside, it looks like maybe it's not as far along as it may be. A lot of people had thought so. So to make these changes kind of can give them a new path or a new direction that they can possibly go. I mean, speculation's out there, but at this point, I think that that's obviously when you cut story and you cut what's the lead technical side of things, I mean, things aren't going to be the same.
No, they really aren't going to be the same. And he's right. We didn't hear any cuts for Planetside 2, DCUO. We didn't hear any cuts for H1Z1, which just went into early access. I didn't hear any of those people being cut. It was a gutting of the EverQuest franchise games. Now, we do still have some people there that are recognizable. I'm going to get her name correct, but Holly, known as Windstalker on the forums, she is still there, and she put out a release that we'll talk about a little bit later in the episode, explaining where they stand right now. But a lot of the big names and a lot of the faces of this company are just gone overnight. And it's sad to see that. So what do you think, Xaiveir? How is this going to affect?
It's going to affect them, I mean, obviously a lot. As you mentioned, most of the cuts that actually wound up happening was cut from the EQ1 team, was cut from the EQ2 team, the older games in their portfolio. H1Z1, as you said, was hardly touched. And to me, it just speaks that they believe that those games may be past their prime, that those resources that we're going to go there, they're going to reinvest on the newer properties. At DCUO, I think they still think there's, especially as they start pouring over to consoles like they want to, that's where most of their money's going to be. So unfortunately, it looks fairly bleak from a perspective on the EQ and EQ2 side of things.
Which is sad, because EQ and EQ2 is going to be a main source of hype and a main source of I guess you could just say, feeding into EverQuest Next and Landmark. I mean, these are the people that are your core audience. Now, obviously, with a AAA MMO like EverQuest Next, you're looking for a broader audience than just who you already have. And the hype train that was rolling off of those announcements they made about the game in the past couple of years has definitely brought in a new attention that EverQuest 2 and EverQuest wasn't bringing. But those are that's your core crowd. These are the people that grew up with EverQuest. These are the people that know and love this IP. And I'd hate to see them abandon us before we have somewhere else to go. That's a really scary thought. Definitely is a scary thought. Now, things like DCUO and things like Planetside 2, they do have a very healthy presence on the console. So I can't say I'm too incredibly surprised that they didn't touch it at all, because if this is a company that is putting forth the idea that they want to become more multi-platform and they want to become more of a mobile and a console concept as well as a PC concept, I can imagine why DCUO and Planetside 2 would be appealing for them, because those are games that are easily transitioned between the two. DCUO has done very well on both Xbox One and the other, and PS4. They definitely are popular in those worlds, so I can see why they wouldn't want to touch those. H1Z1, being as it's new, I can only assume that's why they didn't really gut it. I'm aware that the H1Z1 team isn't that big to begin with. I mean, at SOE Live, we pretty much saw all of them, and it was a pretty small group. It's more of a passionate group, I will say that. So obviously, this is pretty scary. There's some major names coming out. As a fanboy, it kind of makes my heart hurt a little bit. I mean, when it comes down to the next convention, and Brass isn't going to be there, and Georgeson isn't going to be there, it's just not going to be the same. That's sad. But that's more of a personal thing. I don't know from a business perspective if that really comes into play, but for me, it is really sad. So when it comes to this abrupt change, how do you guys think this actually came about? Why do you think Sony was done with Sony Online Entertainment after, I mean, what was it, 96, 97 that EverQuest 1 came out around then? I mean, it's been a long time, 15 plus years. why was now the time to cut bait and run? What do you guys think, Gallows?
Well, I think that anytime there's a change coming in, there's basically one of two directions you have to go. I mean, you have to you come in, you stabilize things, you put a PR announcement out that basically says, you know, discloses transparency and, hey, rest assured, we're gonna keep things business as usual, or you come in and you clean house. It appears that they're cleaning house, and from the outside, being the least experienced again, to me, it has a lot of similarities with you know, restructuring any type of business out there. Mm-hmm. That if you don't get rid of the chief and the executives, then it's just going to kind of linger. And if you come in, especially as a new company, and you see problems, then you're gonna cut. And the problem with that, though, that we've always talked about, even in other things, is that if you don't have something better to replace what you have, then you're kind of being a little counterproductive. So I'm hoping that they have done a little research, or maybe they're actually doing that right now, and they're trying to find voids. You know, the places to plug in for those things that are now void. So it just speaks to the fact that, from me looking at it, it appears that they came in, they saw that there was probably a problem. That's my biggest thing by seeing all this stuff. If they see that there's a problem, they're going to make changes, and I think that it's going to give them a whole different direction. Now, the way you can look at this is you can say, yes, okay, we cut all these people who have been the lifeblood of this, you know, this gaming platform that's come along and the reiterations of it. But if we don't basically start on a new path and direction, then we're just going to get kind of the same false promises and things like that I've heard have existed with those things, you know, with the timelines, and maybe some of those changes will bring about, you know, something more positive out of it. So essentially, to make a long story short, I think it's probably going to hurt it. It's going to hurt EverQuest Next specifically. And I think that it's going to delay it. I think it will still come out because, I mean, that's a huge title. But I think that overall, it may actually be beneficial. If they're having problems, they correct it. They take a step backwards to take two forward.
Okay, so before I let you jump in there, Xaiveir, because I know that you have a very strong opinion, you have a passion for this company, even higher than myself. Before I let you jump in, I want to read something I found online. And this comment was from Reddit, and it was actually from a user named, let me get his name correct here, Spoony Dinosaur. And Spoony Dinosaur looked at this from a completely different perspective. And I like the way he looked at it, and I think this is an interesting twist on it. And some of it was actually covered by Gallows just now, but I'm going to go ahead and read this for you guys. So it says, here's my two cents, and this is, of course, Spoony Dinosaur talking. Let's try and look at it in the eyes of the publisher. The guy's writing checks, you know, the people writing the checks. So SOE is notorious for not firing lazy programmers and having lackluster management and development cycles. This was pretty apparent with the lack of anything EverQuest Next related in general. So it's sad to see Dave leave. He's half the reason I stuck around so long. His passion and excitement was palpable. But maybe this might just be a blessing in disguise. They seem to lack focus and leadership. A kick in the ass might be just what they need to finally get things moving. The company has a lot of dreamers, but not a whole lot of drive or a tangible vision. In its current state, Next seemed to be nothing more than a collection of ideas. But ideas don't make money. It also makes working on these projects difficult. A lot of previous SOE developers have commented on how they never had true focus or drive. They would sort of jump around from project to project, but not actually get anything done. So in comes this new publisher, making the tough calls. I don't agree with them pulling Dave. He was such a charismatic and enthusiastic voice. Hell, I followed H1Z1 through the whole debacle of launch day. He was on his Twitter until 12 a.m., his time communicating with the fans, the interaction with the community is what keeps the hype alive. But more importantly, keeps people interested. At this point, what little community was left is going to part ways, especially for those of us who have no interest in Landmark. He was the reason I was sticking around. So now that we've learned that there's been more cutoffs, specifically Steve Doniser and Eric Smith, which is when this was written, we realize they've been let go. I have extremely limited faith that this won't be the end of Next, that Columbus Nova will galvanize what's left of the projects, churn out as much as they can with Landmark H1Z1 and move on to the next dollar. A part of me likes to believe that maybe this is what they need, a hard kick in the ass with actual development cycles and direction, and maybe we will see Next, but I'm very skeptical. I can't see them bringing in a new team to pick up the pieces, not when they are cutting some of the most integral parts of development. It's such wasted potential. I read that the other day when everybody was kind of emotional about losing these big names, and it was a different perspective I hadn't really thought of. I was throwing my arms up the air and saying, why would you get rid of these people? How are you cutting these people? I have a loyalty to these people. Why are you doing this? And I almost took it personally. But the more I stepped back, and to Gallows' point he said a moment ago, maybe this was in response to a problem. Maybe they're doing this, hopefully, they're doing this to spark something. They have a vision. They want a final product. They want actual progress. What we saw from SOE Live, or Fanfare, excuse me, in 2013, and then what we saw in 2014, they reworked aspects, but we didn't see a lot of progress. We didn't see a lot of tangible progress. We saw, here's enough to keep you excited. Don't think about the fact that it's been a year, and this is all we're giving you. So once you really start to think about the progress made on EverQuest Next and the front-facing announcements on EverQuest Next, it was kind of scary. I don't know why we really didn't notice that or why I hadn't noticed it before, but it was kind of scary. So is this a move by Columbus Nova to fix something that was broken, or is this a move by Columbus Nova to take control of the new company? So what do you think there, Xaiveir? What do you think this is about?
Basically, I mean, anytime you get an investment company like this, you have to look through it through their eyes. I think they see a very valuable product in EverQuest Next, the potential of H1Z1, and the potential of DCO, those being the newer properties that are going to garner the most attention, and Planetside also, that have a very strong base and can be deemed profitable. And then they see things like EverQuest and EverQuest Next and anything else that comes along with it as just the fat off the meat that they actually want. And unfortunately, again, looking through their eyes, they're seeing something that can be very, very profitable with the EverQuest tagline just in and of itself. That's going to sell. You know, you slap EverQuest on something, there's enough people out there that are going to want to play it just because of the name. And again, you go back to the problems in development that they've had, continuing delaying. They've remade the game skins multiple times, and we haven't seen much progress. It almost is getting to a point where if you're not going to come out with it soon, or soon being 1 or 2 years, it's going to lose the profitability of it. It's going to lose the excitement of it. So, and then coming in and taking over, cutting everything else out, and then they're going to fully put all their resources in those games and really make those profitable. Does that mean the death of EQ1 and EQ2? Most likely not. I mean, those games have high enough population where they can last for quite some time. I mean, EQ1, it has had a much smaller dev team than EQ2 has in the past, and it's still going, and you know, fairly strong. But really what they're looking at is the name of EverQuest and what they can do with that name and putting a game out quickly. Going back with, you know, why Dave was let go, which, again, he's a great guy, and just as your Reddit comment user commented on, was his personality, he was the face of the EverQuest franchise. And unfortunately, that franchise has taken a downturn. For as charismatic and loving of the games as he is, apparently they saw a problem. And whether that was him, or he was part of it, or just too high of salary, whatever the reason is, they decided to go a different direction because they see the head guy of it, and no progress made in the last 3-4 years on it. That's why he had to go. It's unfortunate. That's kind of what they're looking at. Is they're looking at what the most profitable things are of the entire former SOE game libraries were, and that EverQuest Next is going to be the most profitable one along with DCO and PlanetSide.
Yeah, I could definitely see that. It's sad to see Dave go. Like I said, it's almost something you take personally after following this guy for so long. But at the same time, it really, the progress wasn't there. I mean, they had to have come in, they had to have seen something wrong, and you can't start change without removing the old. You can't ask for new without removing the old, and I think that's kind of what they're going for. And while it's sad to see the old EverQuest team go, these names and these faces, I hope it's going to result in something positive. Now, where my fear comes from, and where all of our fear comes from, I think, is who is Columbus Nova? They're not a game company. They have zero experience in games whatsoever. If this was, the headline was Blizzard Entertainment bought Sony Online Entertainment and they're now called Daybreak Games, I would be okay with that because I would have faith that this company knows what they're doing. They're going to take this franchise that I love and they're going to turn it into something great. But really, some stranger just walked up on the street and purchased something I care deeply for, and I don't know what they're going to do with it. And they're not telling us what they're going to do with it. All we're getting is canned responses. So the lack of transparency and the lack of any knowledge of who these people are really incites fear in me more than anything else. And I'm disappointed that they're not coming forward and being more transparent, knowing that everybody's kind of freaking out right now about the future of their game. But I hope that they have an idea there. So what do you think there about who Columbus Nova even is?
Well, you know, we've all of us, I think, have tried to paint a positive light on this thing because the alternative is really scary.
Yeah.
You know, the other option is, you know, here is an investment company coming in, knows nothing about games, and they're strictly going by the numbers. They're just axing, you know, costs. And they want to turn a profit. And it could be really easy to get in the mindset of, you know what, we've got a name, we've got the IP, it's bound to make money no matter what we dish out. So let's cut our overhead and put out more profit. That's scary to me. And that's a possibility. And,
it is.
And one I hope that doesn't happen.
There is one other possibility that, while I hope is unlikely, I can't help but have a lingering in the back of my mind, and that is that this is akin to someone buying a business, walking into the retail store and seeing that this wasn't as successful as they thought, and to start to gut it for parts. And I really hope that doesn't happen. I hope they don't come in and, as an investment group, have a different definition of what is profitable. Look at EverQuest 1, look at EverQuest 2, not think about the fact that there's a passion behind that community and a love for that community with nostalgia, and they go, it's profitable, but it's not profitable enough for us to waste time on it. All you people are on Next. EverQuest 2 is done. EverQuest 1 is done. And that's a fear that I can't seem to shake that might happen. Now, is it going to happen tomorrow? Probably not. This is something that they're going to take a while looking at the books, finding out exactly what's going on. But I can't shake that, and it's a really scary thought. What do you think about that, Xaiveir?
It is a really scary thing, but you know, I don't think about that as much, though. When you have an investment company like that that's going to come in and buy a property, obviously the value they see in the company is higher than what it currently is. Otherwise, they wouldn't buy it. I think they can come through. They can take the main franchises, EverQuest Next, those kind of things, and their idea would be, okay, we're going to buy this low, and we need to trim off the fat, you know, your costs, your developers, certain aspects, certain people in there that were probably making too much money. Now I can go now get somebody that was just out of college now to do it for half the cost. Now I've turned this around. I have a healthy staff if they do wind up replacing these people. We're turning a profit, we'll then grow it, and then eventually, you know, turn around and sell it for double what they paid for. That's essentially what the investment property, you know, somebody like Nova will wind up doing or want to do with it. I don't think, you know, you're a year or two away, and we wouldn't even hear anything probably August, September, October later on this year before everything really changes or we hear really anything of their plans, which is unfortunate because in an investment company like that, they don't care about me and you. They don't care about the game players. They don't care about the community. They just see dollar signs. That's how they got their money. Is by doing this over and over and over. So I think having Nova onus is really not going to be all that long, you know, in the grand scheme of things, you know, a couple of years or so. I don't think they'll wind up carving pieces out and selling them that way. I think the game library as a whole has some value to it. You know, now that unfortunately, like Vanguard is gone, they dumped a lot of money. Can't remember the field game. Yeah. And so say that again.
Star Wars Clone Adventures was the other kid's one they had that failed.
Yeah, I mean, it was Free Realms. There was, I cannot remember the name of the game that they started producing for a long time, and then they just, it never opened. The Agency.
That's right. I remember that.
Yeah, they dumped a bunch of cash into that. Yeah. So I think that's gone now. And now they just have the meat that's left over. So they'll wind up building those up. Your less profitable games, and again, unfortunately, we don't have the numbers to know exactly how much EQ makes or how much EQ2 makes or how much DCUO makes or how much PlanetSide makes to make a real intelligent decision on, you know, which games or forecast which games are going to wind up, you know, cutting down. Gutting of the staff's kind of told us that, though. And so now they'll just build them up. They'll probably keep on still developing, still doing things, probably at a slower rate. But there's still money to be made there. And then once the Next is launched and everything, they'll probably wind up turning around and selling it all as a whole for double what they had to, hopefully, somebody like a Blizzard or somebody that knows more about games.
So Xaiveir makes a good point about the investment companies coming in. You know, on the flip side of things, maybe this brings upon like a surge of capital that comes in. They're going to invest in the product, build it back up to sell it, or at least, you know, gain profits on it. So that may be something that their idea is there. My only issue about that kind of thing is the fact that they have ditched their story guy. I mean, you have somebody who's been basically building from the ground up the story work of EverQuest Next. So, Xaiveir, I mean, what are your thoughts on that? Because to me, that's like a key element of maybe even possibly just rebooting and restarting over. Do you think that they can pick up from that? You know, from the what they have, or maybe they don't have enough. What are your thoughts?
You know, it is kind of troubling. I mean, anytime you take your head guy and you know, especially with the story of EverQuest Next. In a way, it's the more I think about it, it's not as troubling because you have a team of writers, just like you would with a movie or anything else. And if their vision isn't aligning with what, in this case, Nova wants, they're going to get ruined. But you still have all your writers. So, in two different ways here. I mean, first of all, obviously it's troubling, but the other one is, you know, maybe his vision just didn't line up, and maybe it's his vision that was causing a lot of the delays with the storyline. Maybe, I guess what I'm trying to say is only time will tell that. It is troubling in a way, but also you still retain a lot of writers that you already have, that have already have work. So they already have a conglomeration of work there, you know, for them to use. So I don't think it's going to be a start over. I think it's way too, well, they've only restarted three times. So I can't say it's too late in the game to start over again. But I think they're going to want to push a product, and I think they're going to want it quicker. And they're probably going to get somebody in. They probably are just going to promote somebody that's already in their storyline up to that position. Probably at a lesser cost, too.
So what do you think about the possible influx of capital?
Well, the influx of capital, and Gallows makes a great point, is it could, you know, as a standalone company now, you're not answering to Sony. And as we know, Sony has, as an entire corporation, has posted quite a few losses lately, and I think that's eventually what led to the sale, is they just, Sony never really wanted to, or understood, I guess, an online studio or an online gaming company. So by moving here over with Nova, and then it is possible that there's going to be some cash that comes in. They say, okay, we have to make this profitable. So to do so, we're going to dump a whole bunch of cash here. Once all of their, again, to go back to the old analogy of cutting off the fat off of the piece of meat that you want, and then they go ahead and they bring their own guys in to oversee it and make sure the cash is being spent right in a timely manner, things are getting done the way they want it done. So in a way, it could be very, very good. And it goes, when you're saying with EQ and EQ1, it could mean an influx of cash for them. I know EQ2 is a profitable game too, and I think it can be even more profitable if it was allowed to have its own source of money, its own budget per se. And that, if there is cash that comes in with this deal, which I really hope there is, and again, we won't know for months and months and months how that's going to affect it, it could really grow the games like they should. For instance, EQ2, for as big of a title as it is and as big of a name as EverQuest is, it was marketed incredibly poorly. And one of the things that were always said was money. Well, if they bring in money, if they continue to develop the game, if they then show it off to the world, that in and of itself is going to help grow and make it more profitable.
That's a very good point. We're just kind of stuck sitting at the edge of our seats waiting to see what happens, waiting to see the results and what it is that's really on their mind. The only real word we've gotten from the inside of any of these games about this, aside from the small tweets and stuff that like Dave Georges has put out, etc., is from Holly Longdale from the EverQuest team, the executive producer of EQ1 and EQ2, otherwise known as Windstalker. And I'll read that to you guys now. It was on the EverQuest 2 forums. So it says, "Hello, Narathians. As you've likely heard by now, there's been some changes around here in staff. I want to assure you, though, that this team is still in full-time dev and operation mode, and we continue to have awesome plans for EverQuest 2. We're shuffling a few things about, but our goals in delivering fun stuff won't change. For example, in a couple of weeks, we'll be releasing rare bosses for the AOM dungeons and more. We're tinkering a bit, so I apologize for the silence and certainly any concerns or worry I may have caused you. We'll have more news as we rip along here doing what we do and what we love, which is keeping our world busy and alive for our incredible community of players. Above all, we are grateful for your continued support and love of the game." And then she goes on to say that she would really like to hear from everyone and chat with you about all of this, which is why we will be hosting a Twitch live stream on Wednesday, February 18th at 3 p.m. on the EverQuest 2 Twitch channel. The team looks forward to having you tune in so we can address any questions you may have. Thanks, and see you in game, Holly. Now, two things here stuck out to me. One is, we're recording this on the 14th of February, so that live stream has not occurred yet. But I couldn't imagine that live stream being very transparent. When I hear this, I hear a different kind of press release. Now, Holly's great. And she does, from what I understand and what I know, great work on these games. And she was very nice. We met her at SOE Live, and she was just a wonderful person. And I don't think it had anything to do with her choice of what to say or what not to say. This sounds like this is the message, one company, this is what you're going to put out. And she probably pushed because she wanted to say something, because she wanted to address the fans. And her passion for the product is probably what resulted in this being posted at the forums. But it sounds very controlled. It sounds...
sounds like damage control.
It sounds like damage control.
It just sounds very calculated and almost kind of form letter-ish.
Yeah.
Because she in all honesty, though, she can't say anything. She really can't say much. There's hush-hush on this, and she really doesn't have the authority to really speak for the company. So... I'm really wondering if it's not going to be more the same, even with this live stream. Because I think at the end of the day, she's not going to be allowed to say much.
Yeah, so. I can't imagine the live stream being any more than, we can't really tell you anything about that yet, but good things are on the way kind of thing. You know, more of a cheerleader session. Like, we're going to try to pump you up, you know, give you a few nuggets, a piece in each game that's being released. You know, it's business as usual, rah, rah, rah. But you can't help but be skeptical that you're not really getting the whole story. It's like an advertisement on TV. They're showing you exactly what they want you to see. I want more of the transparency. So before we go into my next topic, I want to ask Xaiveir, what do you think about this press release and what it means, Xaiveir?
Well, you guys kind of hit it on the head. You know, first of all, I've met Holly. I've hung out with her. She's a wonderful, wonderful person. But honestly, with the takeover just being announced, I want to say it's been about a week and a half ago. Again, this is February 14th. So about a week and a half ago. I don't know if she knows that much. I think it speaks to her love for the game, that she knew that she had to put something out there for people, that silence was absolutely the worst thing that could possibly happen, is silence from the people that are controlling the game. The response in and of itself, it was very formulator, but it had to be. Either A, she didn't know certain specifics, B, she was told she couldn't say certain specifics, or C, she just could only take time to do a little bit, and then they're going to reveal more stuff on Wednesday. So really, I don't read too much into it. It was very nice to hear something from the producer, the head of the entire franchise, coming on and saying, hey, you know, we're still here. We're still developing. We're still going. But, I mean, honestly, she may not even know what the future holds, you know, a couple months down the road or 6 months down the road, other than, you know, Noah could have come to her and said, you know, yeah, we're still going to, you know, give you guys resources to develop the game. To what capacity, she may not know. So, really, I think what she said was everything she could say, and there wasn't anything more. Going to the live Twitch stream, It's going to be a cheerleading session. I think by then they're going to know more. After just having all these layoffs and everything also, I can imagine it was a whirlwind over there the last few days. And so there wasn't a lot of time to prepare anything other than a quick statement. But it's a standard statement that, you know, any game company or any company in general is going to give, whether you're in sports, whether you're in entertainment, whether you're in online gaming, whether you're in, you know, a fast food restaurant, they're going to have the same type of response. So I don't read too much into it. I think I'm going to wait and see to the live stream and then go from there.
Okay. So a concern that's really hitting me when it comes to all of this is SOE took a direction. I don't know exactly when the direction was changed. I want to say it was Fanfare a couple years ago, where they coined this open development concept, where they were putting roadmaps out, they were getting a lot of community involvement in their development process, and they were putting forth a certain level of transparency in the development of these games. You see a lot of it with Landmark, we saw quite a bit of it with H1Z1, and I really liked that. It felt more like what indie developers do, where they really bring their fans in because they know those are the opinions that matter. And they want to balance the, we need to make money, but we need to make a good game that people want to play. So they were being very open, and they were using player votes, even going as far as Landmark, where they were building the pieces for EverQuest Next. And I really liked that. And I can't not say that that scares me. I mean, it scares me that this is going to go away. It was a new era in SOE that showed that they were really listening to the people that mattered, the people that play their games. And I enjoyed voting in those. I enjoyed reading the roadmaps and seeing that the future of this product that I care about was going in a direction that I agreed with or that I was passionate about. I liked the open communication. Do we think that this is going to be the death of that? Not just in the immediate future while they're changing things, but just going forward, they're going to go to more of a traditional we'll build the game, we'll tell you press releases we want you to know, and when it comes out, you'll play it. What do you think, Xaiveir?
I don't think it's going to change too much. I think you'll see it in the next month or so, where it'll be hush-hush and everything until they figure out where they're going. And then at that point, I don't think it's going to change too much. Having a new owner, being Nova in this case, isn't going to change what Sony does what Daybreak Games does from an operation standpoint, unless it's detrimental, and you see that as they make changes. I don't think that's going to be a change that they're going to make. I think it'd be incredibly stupid to cut that out if that is Nova. And the reason being is, being in the technology age now, we want information fast. The players want information fast. And with the mediums to do that, being the internet, being Twitter, being Facebook, being Reddit, all these options to get information out there, it would behoove them to get as much information out there as possible and as quickly as possible. That's how people interact now. I think you're going to actually see more gaming companies, or more companies in general, doing that. I don't think they're going to cut that out.
Now, I recall sometime back, I don't recall exactly when, there was a community manager. He was on all of the Landmark podcasts and all the Landmark streams, and he had left the company. And I remember that he had left the company, and I want to say this was like 5-6 months back, maybe a little bit longer. And when he finally did break his silence and say why he was leaving, it was because he liked the open development and this open concept, but he didn't agree with how Sony was forcing them to do it. He didn't like the direction of it. Do you recall who that was, Xaiveir? Do you remember that?
You know, I don't remember his name off the top of my head.
Yeah, I can't remember his name. It's like the tip of my tongue. But I'm wondering if that was Sony's control. And on the flip side of my fear I had stated a moment ago, I wonder if this is going to change it to be more of that original vision. That original vision where this really was a transparency. And it might take a little while for Columbus Nova to say, yeah, let's do that. Let's get that fan buy-in. Let's really open the doors up. To a reasonable amount, of course, and not control it like it sounds like Sony was doing. Now, of course, we have no way of knowing if that was just an upset employee on the way out, throwing dirt. But the way it was worded and the way it was presented, it really seemed like he had a vision for what that open development was going to be, and the company had controlled it in a way that he felt was misrepresenting the original vision.
They have to be careful with their transparency, though, too, because, mm-hmm. I mean, if anything wasn't pretty clear was, the H1Z1, you will not pay, you will not be paid to win, and then the announcement of airdrops and crates and things like that. Yeah. So that has a tendency to kind of come back and bite you in the butt, so you have to be very careful. Unless you have a very laid out, detailed plan ahead of you, exactly what you're going, which in this case, I probably don't think that's probably established. So that transparency, it's tough sometimes.
Yeah,
too.
It is hard to balance. It is very scary to balance, I would imagine.
Yeah.
Okay. So do we think we are going to see, and I'll give each of you a chance to answer, the death of any of SOE's current games? I don't believe it will. If any game was going to get the chopping block, I would think it would be EQ1, because while I do believe it's profitable, I couldn't imagine it being very profitable. So if any of the games were going to get axed, I would think it would be EQ1. I really hope that doesn't happen, though. What do you think, Alex?
Well, I don't see anything right off the top of my head that strikes as that they're going to cut immediately. I mean, especially with the announcement of consoles and phones, the IPs are there to be able to be used with other devices. So initially, I think no. But the other way to think about it, too, is it may not be profitable enough with the extent that maybe some of these resources that are being used, although probably small teams, may be able to be focused somewhere else into other bigger projects and help speed things along if that's the problem. I mean, if we're worried about a slow developing and somebody wanting to come in and pump out products, they probably would at least entertain the idea of refocusing some of those tools to expedite things.
It's especially since some of these people are pulled in a lot of different directions. I remember at SOE Live or Fanfare this last year when we were covering it, that the H1Z1 people said multiple times that a lot of the resources they're utilizing is from the Landmark team, that these people are cross teams. And that tells me that they're short on people or short on capital, or that they're really stretching people as far as they can. So that could be an option. What do you think, Xaiveir? Anything going to get the chopping block?
I don't think anything's going to be chopped off right away. With something like this in an investment firm, they're going to do their due diligence and take a lot of time in analyzing each one of their properties and whether or not that they can infuse more money in it to make it more profitable. If it's costing too much money to chop it, they move kind of at a snail's pace in a way when they're evaluating their assets. So in immediate future, no. Probably I would have to go with EQ1. If anything was going to get chopped, it would probably be that. I think it's going to give you the least amount of return in investment. And Gallows is absolutely right. If they're spending X amount of money over here to get X amount of money in return, but they can go over here and get a much higher return for the same amount of money, they're going to wind up cutting it. I don't think it would be good for them to cut it all the way. It just may make it a skeleton crew, similar to how Vanguard was handled there towards the end of it, where they just kind of let things go. Because if you just cut a game like that, especially when you're trying to develop another one of the same name, being EverQuest Next, if you're going to cut EQ1, you've pretty much immediately lost all players from EQ1 going to EQ Next. And that would not
I hope they realize that.
I do too. I really do. Because if you cut EQ1, everybody that plays EQ1 or EQ2 or whatever they end up cutting, they will stop playing Daybreak Games. Absolutely 110%. I know a lot of people that played Landmark that when they cut that out, they're gone. Never going to play a Sony game again at the time. Same with Star Wars Galaxies. I heard a ton of people say, I am never touching that company again after what they did. I really hope they get that, because EverQuest Next has the potential to be the next biggest MMO. And with the correct marketing and everything, it could bring back older players from EQ that maybe haven't been in the game for a while, play other games, that kind of thing. If you cut those, it's going to hurt them. So I hope they know that. So I don't see them cutting anything anytime soon. They may not put as much resources as they had before in it, but nothing on the immediate horizon. I would say one 2 years minimum.
Okay. So do we think that this is going to result in a slower release for EverQuest Next and official release of H1Z1, Landmark, Planetside on PS4, or do we think that this is going to speed things up? And obviously we know that there's going to be some restructuring, and it's going to take them a while to get going, but if things really were as slow and as clunky, and it's non-focused, I shouldn't say clunky, I should say non-focused, as it appears that people are trying to say it was, even with that setback, I think this might end up with a faster turnaround. I think we might actually see, and we'll never know because we don't know when SOE would have released this game, but I think this could end up with us having a faster turnaround. Unless this just turns into Candy Crush Norath and we see 13 iterations of Facebook and mobile games where they milk the IP until it's done. And man, that scares me. That made my heart drop a little bit. But it
scares me a lot.
It's a possibility because we know how much money those games make, and we know that a lot of companies are having trouble staying away from that. And well, I should say, you don't have to stay away from it, but if you're going to do it right. Make a good game, make it worth it. Don't just cash in on the mobile scene and the Facebook scene. So what do you guys think? Do you think this is going to result in a faster, a slower, or just a bunch of mobile games?
Well, I think it really depends on the title. I think with EverQuest Next, that's the hardest one to pin down just simply because we don't know where it is in development. with as many times as it's been restarted, and there was rumors that it was they were cutting some things now, that they were taking steps back on it again. I thought that it was going to be pretty close to the way that it was presented, that it was getting close to alpha release, would have been middle of this year or so. With the new company taking over, I think it's going to take a little bit longer with EverQuest Next, especially if they did fire the lead storyteller, you know, certain things like that. They didn't like where it was going. I think that one will take longer. I think H1Z1 may come along a little bit faster, just simply because it is so close to being done. Granted, there's a lot of issues still with it. I think they see that as, okay, this game can make money. The zombie genre, that bubble may burst soon where people just don't care about zombies anymore. So I think H1Z1 will get pushed out first to get an influx of more money, essentially making their property more valuable.
What do you think, Gallows?
Yeah, it's really tough. It's tough because you don't know how much they had, how much meat was there, what you're starting with. If they had quite a bit and they're going to refocus, retool, and then push forward, then yeah, I think it could be earlier than what would normally be. But with all things being equal here, I think that it's definitely a step backwards. I think that just from the aspect of all of the cuts that they've made and all of the new direction that they're going, I think that they're going to be taking a step backwards. Does this take it longer to develop? Yes, I do. However, once they get their feet underneath them, I think that essentially it's going to speed things up drastically. So the initial release maybe take longer, but I think progressing from that point on, I think that it will probably end up benefiting them, because I think it will speed things along a lot quicker in the whole development cycle of once we get to that point.
Okay. So one last thing I want to ask you guys. So last year, we covered SOE Live, or Fanfare. It was the first convention this channel covered, and it was a blast. I had a ton of fun. Myself and Xaiveir covered the show. Do you think we're going to see a Fanfare this year? Are they going to utilize this as an opportunity to come out as a new company and present who they are and what they stand for? Or are they just going to say, maybe next year, sorry? Because it's already been scheduled. The site's already up. Are they just going to pull it? What do you think, Xaiveir?
Well, they announced that they're pulling it. There is going to be no Fanfare this year at all, which is unfortunate. I think it would have been a great idea for this company to say, okay, here's Daybreak Games. We're new. Same people or mostly the same people, but we're brand new. We're taking this thing serious and giving them a chance to reintroduce themselves to the fans. But they did say there will not be a Fanfare this year, which is really sad about it. It's always a great time there. There is a community-driven Fanfare that is trying to gain legs. Yeah, I saw it on Facebook, where there are people that normally go to Fanfare. They're going to put on a unofficial Fanfare, though. But as far as an official Fanfare, they've said it won't be here. And to be completely honest, I don't know if they'll put on one the following year or the following year after that.
Could be the death of Fanfare. Well, I did not know that they had announced they were not doing it anymore. That is sad to hear. At least not doing it this year. I think it would have been a perfect opportunity for them to come out and really present themselves, even if they had to postpone until the end of the year. I think this could have been a way for them to buy that loyalty back, to show their passion, to prove us wrong, I guess. All the naysayers out there saying that this is a bad purchase, this is a bad thing, and all the people on the internet right now screaming out that this is the death of SOE and what SOE stands for. I would like to see them just come out and on stage, person to person, and just say, it's wrong. This is who we are. This is what we're doing. Are you with us? And I'm sad to see that's not going to happen. I really am sad.
That may be the case, though, too. They may have something that comes along the line that they want to promote to that degree. I just think that with all this happening, that it kind of makes sense. I think that they're definitely going to do things on their timeline, and something that was pre-scheduled like that, if they're not ready to have big announcements, because I can guarantee you, the fans there's very little upside to that, and there's more downside that can happen, because they want to hear big news, they want to hear big things, and if the timeline isn't ready for it, if the company isn't ready to divulge that to the public and to the fans, I think that it could just be too detrimental. So I think that from a business standpoint, that was probably necessary.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Absolutely.
I can see that. So that's where we're going to end this today. So obviously the three of us, and I'm confident in the fact that I can speak to this, wish this company the best. We want to see this succeed. We want to see a successful H1Z1. We want to see a successful EverQuest Landmark and EverQuest Next. I want to see PlanetSide 2 hit the PS4 successfully. I want to see EverQuest 2 and EverQuest 1 and all these wonderful franchises, DCUO with this channel has had a lot of success with. I want to see them thrive. And I want this to end up to be a positive. I want to look back in a year, 6 months to a year, and go, I'm really glad that happened. This was something it needed, and I didn't realize it needed, but I am glad that it happened. So I'm very curious to hear what you guys think out there. So leave us a comment down below what you think. Is this a good thing? Is this a bad thing? Any of the topics we discussed today, chime in. This is your chance. Tell us you think we're right, we're wrong. Tell us you think we're crazy. Whatever you want to say, there's your forum. Okay, so I want to know from you guys, what do you think of this type of discussion? Do you like the podcast style of content? Would you like to see us revisit other topics like this? Let us know. This can be a regular thing for us. This could be something that we could discuss what's on our mind, discuss what's hot in the news right now, and give our differing opinions on it, give our analytical thoughts on it. If this is something that entertains you, let us know in the comments. I'd really like to know. Don't forget to like, favorite, subscribe, all that great stuff. We have a lot of content, a lot of varied content coming out, and we would love you to be part of the ride. So that's all for today, and we'll see you next time.